for your presentation, Zohar. Thank you to all of you for your attendance. I'm Israel Garcia, as Zohar said. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Sevilla in Spain. Today, I'm going to try to explain in 1 hour how you can apply it in a practical way, the coupled criterion of the finite fracture mechanics to a problem that you are studying in your own research. This is a kind of tutorial. So this is the objective of my presentation. Well, this is the simplified version of the table of contents. First of all, after that, we are going to develop the table of contents, but for now, this is okay. First of all, we are going to introduce the coupled criterion. Actually, it was already introduced by Dominique, but we are going to make some comments on that. And we are going to apply it to a very simple problem in order to illustrate the application, the easy application to a problem. But after that, we are going to see what type of complexity you can find when you try to apply the coupled criterion to your problem. Okay, with that in mind, we are going to explain a general formulation of the coupled criterion that can be applied to any problem using linear elastic materials. Finally, after this general formulation, we are going to explain some examples of application which span a wide variety of problems and complexity that you can find. Well, first, some words about crack initiation under static loading, because this is a really underdeveloped concept due to two main reasons. The first one is this is really a controversial concept, because if you take a material before loading, you can find at the microscope that you have already cracks existing at this material without applying any load. So what is the sense of crack initiation under static loading? Well, we are going to explain a little bit about that in next slide. Other problem is that the classical fracture mechanics criterion, that is the Griffith criterion that many of you studied, is unable to predict crack initiation, because the critical load for a crack propagating typically tends to infinite, when the crack length tends to zero. So if you want to predict crack initiation with the Griffith criterion, typically it's not possible. However, despite of this fact, crack initiation is a very important problem. Why? Because it's mainly the first step of some failure mechanism that you can find in some materials. So we need to understand what are predicting when we speak or we talk about crack initiation. And this led to the concept of crack initiation. Let's see in this schematic what we are going to understand in this slide as crack initiation. If you take a plate with some geometry that leads to a stress concentration around this point, for example, subjected to tension, a very simple problem. If you take a microscope and you observe well the material before loading, you find that the material are going to have a floor defects or even micro cracks, depending on the material nature. But if you so there is already cracks. So what we are going to understand as crack initiation in this finite fracture mechanics is the next one. If you load your specimen, you are going to have that these flows or these defects are going to grow. And they are going to grow depending on the stresses that you are going to find in the macroscopic scale. So if you increase the load more, you are going that the stresses around this point, for example, in this example, is going to be larger than at point where stresses are lower. And at sometimes this micro crack or defects are going to coalesce. And when these cracks or micro cracks coalesce, we're going to have a crack. And this crack at this moment, we are going to have a crack at the macroscopic scale. But previously to that, we don't have a crack at this scale. Maybe we have some softening, that is what called damage, but we are not going to have a crack. So what we call crack initiation is when the crack or defects go or jumps from a scale to another scale. This is what we call crack initiation. So it's some type of simplification to study the problem to a macroscopic level. It's actually is something that we use a lot. For example, we use a lot that for elastic modulus. We know that elastic modulus is some type of macroscopic property, because if we measure that at the microscopic level, we are going to have other value, but it's some type of mean of the or average of the value. So this is what we are going to understand as crack initiation in the rest of this slide. So how we can study or predict crack initiation from the point of view of a practical problem? Well, we have several models or several approaches. We have damage mechanics, atomistic modeling, Kosciuszko model, which is actually a type of damage mechanics in some sense. And we have the fourth one is finite fracture mechanics. That's Dominique explained in previous lecture. But we are going to define here finite fracture mechanics as some set of approaches with some common points. This common point is that the critical length governs the crack initiation. We are going to assume that the crack is going to jump from some length to another length, typically if we don't have a crack, from zero to a critical length in a some finite jump. Okay, we are not going to have intermediate steps. And with this idea, there are several criteria that have been proposed. This is very interesting because, as Dominique pointed in the previous lecture, this leads to sample models, some formulation, and this is very subtle for industrial applications. So in this schematic, we can see some of the most important criteria within the finite fracture mechanics. And we can find some based on stress criteria, some based on energy criteria, and some based on CTUD criteria, and others that combine some of these criteria. In particular, we are going to focus on the coupled criterion of the finite fracture mechanics, that is also called hybrid criterion, mixed criterion, and even finite fracture mechanics itself. So, focusing on finite fracture mechanics is a combination of two things. The idea of we have a crack, of we have a crack onset with a finite length, and what I called the Legion hypothesis that says that the crack initiation occurs for the minimum load fulfilling the stress and the energy criteria. This idea, I'm sure Dominique explained before perfectly, but the idea is that we have some extreme cases where the fracture is governed by one condition, for example, in this case on the left, by a stress condition, and this case on the right, governed by an energy condition. But in some intermediate cases, like stress singularities, weak stress singularity actually, or stress concentration, we have to fulfill both criteria. This is the idea. So in what follow, we are going to try to predict crack initiation using this combination and assuming that the crack onset is finite, is with a finite length. So we are going to apply this for a very first sample of application. This is the open hole plate where we have a hole in a plate sufficiently large, and this plate is subjected to tension. This is a very, very small thickness plate. Okay, we can use plane stress. And here it is expected that the crack grow beginning at this point, because as you know, because a classical problem in elasticity, these are the points more loaded. So why this problem is easy? Because the crack path is well known. We know very well that the crack is going to begin at this point. And in addition, we have an analytic solution for stress. We know the stress field around the hole. And we have some not analytic, but almost analytic solution for energy criterion. We can use as an analytic, for the energy, because what we are going to apply the couple criterion, we need two conditions: that the stresses along the path of the future crack, for example, here from the point of the hole to the crack tip of this crack in red, at all these points before the crack onset, we need that the stresses exceed the material strength of the plate. And this is from the point of view of the stress criterion. From the point of view of the energy criterion, we are going to need that the released energy due to the onset of this crack exceed or equal or larger than the dissipated energy inverse on the irreversible processes that are associated to the opening of a crack. So, to evaluate the stress condition, that the stresses exceed some type of material property here, we need the stress field before. And to evaluate the energy criterion, we need the solution after the crack onset and before, to evaluate the release energy during the process. So if we have an analytic solution for the stress criterion, we can impose this condition very easily. And see, if we have analytic solution for the situation after the crack onset, we can also evaluate the energy criterion very easily. So this is what we are going to do in next slides. First, a stress criterion. We have the Kirch's, the classical Kirch expression for stresses, and using that expression, that is for sufficiently large plate, we are going to have that the condition expressed before is writing with this formula or this expression very easily, where sigma infinite is the remote stress that we are applying. Sigma C is the material strength. R, a large R, is the hole radius. And delta L is the crack length that we are assuming. Observe that the value of the remote load, or the limits for the remote load, is going to depend on how large I put the crack. Okay, this is going to be very important after. As for the energy criterion, well, we have some approximative expression for the stress intensity factor in mode one. We know that the problem is in mode one. It's very easy. We have the symmetry planes and all and so on. And with D key one, we can obtain G by the classical relation that we have between the two. And with G, if we have G, the energy release rate between the for each value of the crack length, if we want to know how much energy is released during the crack onset of a finite length, we can integrate this energy release from zero to the final length of the crack. This is what we have here. We put out sigma infinite in order to have insight, in order to not have insight any dependence on sigma infinite, as you can see here. So this is the condition for the energy criterion. So if we combine this with the stress criterion, we can, in this case, we can do this very easily, because we can put the expression for sigma infinite, substituting here this sigma infinite and putting here, and we obtain this equation, or this inequation actually, where you can see that everything is depending here on delta L, because this k1 over sigma infinite to the square is actually this expression except sigma infinite to the square. So everything here depends on material properties or geometrical properties of the problem as R or delta L. So this is an equation for delta L. We can solve this for delta L, obtain the value of delta L and introduce that, for example, here in this equation up to obtain the remote critical, the critical remote stress for the crack onsets. So as you can see, it's just two equations, one integration and solving a nonlinear equation. So it's not, from the mathematical point of view, it's a very easy problem. And we can find very interesting results from a practical point of view. For example, we can plot the remote stress, the critical remote stress leading to a failure, leading to a crack onset over the material strength as a function of the whole diameter. And we can change the material properties to see how the material properties influence or affect to the result. For example, here we have plotted the dependence on GC, on the fracture toughness. And as you can see, for small diameters, for small holes, basically the crack is going to appear for the same load that the plate without hole fails for sigma infinite equal to the material strength. So here there is some independence of the presence of a hole. And for the other strength, for larger holes, we are going to have that the apparent strength of the plates is going to be divided over 3. So this is a very nice result, and this is obtained very easily. But this is a sample application, okay? If you want to apply this to a more complicated problem, we have to use other techniques. And this is what we want to highlight here in this slide. For example, what problem you can find? For example, if you have some geometry, you know that the elastic solution are not a lot in the literature for problems, and you have a complicated geometry. For sure, you're not going to have an analytic solution. You can use several methods, and you can find in the literature example for that. I'm going to do some examples. And you can use, for example, approximative analytic method, as Dominique did in previous lecture, or you can use also extraction from boundary elements or from finite elements or from any computational approach. And in addition, you can use an automatic implementation of the coupled criterion of the finite fracture mechanics. This is very relevant, in particular, if you don't know the crack path, because these first three are very, very useful if you know the crack path or you know some alternative. For example, you know that the crack is going to begin at this point or at this other point. But if you don't know anything about where the crack is going to grow or you're going to onset, you need an automatic implementation. And we speak about that at the end of the presentation. In addition, we can have more complexity if you have, for example, some relevance of shear stresses. That this is very important, for example, for problems with interfaces or with problems where shear stresses are important due to the material. And in addition, you can have more complexity if you have some influence of the fracture motonicity. We will see along this lecture examples of those of all these problems. Well, you are going to develop here now the general formulation. First of all, the stress criterion, we are going to do everything in 3D. because this is, as Dominique highlighted before, it's a very interesting criterion for a 3D problem. So everything here is going to be in 3D. We are going to have in 3D, we can define a function sigma equivalent, that is what we are going to compare to the material strength. And this sigma equivalent can be defined as you want. This typically is going to depend on the material that you have. You know, we have a failure criteria that are very different for metals or for soils or for rocks, etc. This information is what we put here. This is like, for example, the typical equivalent for Mises stress. But this is a generalization of that. So it's very useful in elasticity. So here we can put a tensile criterion, more Coulomb, quadratic, polynomial, etc. This is just a combination of the normal and shear stresses that are in our future surface. And in addition, we can define a functional f, that this is a functional which arguments the sigma equivalent, this function before, and delta sc. Delta sc is the surface that that will be the future crack surface. Okay, this is what previously in 2D problems we call delta L. Delta LC in 2D problems, this is the length of the crack after the onset, but in 3D we need to define this as a surface because it's not just the length of the crack after the onset, it's the surface, it's the geometry of the crack after the onset. And at the surface, in each point of the surface, we will have a normal, and associated to this normal, we will have a normal and shear stresses. So when we call here sigma equivalent as a function of sigma and tau, we will have this normal and shear stresses associated to this surface. What is this functional? This functional is, for example, if we say that the stresses has to exceed in all the points the material strength, this functional will be the maximum of all the points of all the stresses along all these points. Okay, if you are going to study with the average, that is another option used in finite fracture mechanics, the functional will be the average of the stresses along all these points in delta SC. But the important point here is that this functional is going to depend on delta SC. This is going to be key for next slides. Well, if we are able to define this F, this functional F, we just need to compare this F, this functional F, with some material strength that can be a reference. That doesn't mean that the only material property that we are going to introduce here is sigma c. We can put, for example, tau c or other strength properties, but they are going to enter in sigma equivalent, typically by ratios of tau c over sigma c and so on. So this is the expression for the stress criterion in a general formulation. And if we assume a linear elastic material, we can say that all the loads are going to be, or the stresses in sigma equivalent are going to be proportional, directly proportional to a certain sigma zero. That is a load factor that we're taking as a reference. And with that, we will have that the stress criterion can be written, as you can see here, as the ratio of sigma zero to sigma c should be larger or equal to a function s that you can observe here, that can be defined as the inverse of the functional f. So this is very important because in our problem, in all the problem that we study with linear elastic material, we our objective, our practical objective, is to obtain this functional f. If we are able to obtain this functional f, you can solve the problem. As for the energy criterion, we are going to use the same images. And the idea is the application of the first law of thermodynamics, as you can see here, is the sum of delta pi, delta Ek, and delta gamma, where delta pi is a change in elastic energy, delta Ek is the change in kinetic energy, and delta gamma is the dissipated energy. Assuming an initial static loading, delta Ek is going to be larger or equal to zero. So this expression can be simplified to that expression on the bottom, where the release energy should be larger or equal to delta gamma, where delta gamma is the dissipated energy. So to simplify, is the release energy should be equal or larger to the dissipated energy. So our objective to solve a problem is to find delta pi and delta gamma for our problem. So let's begin with delta pi. We have at least three methods to obtain delta pi. The first one is the most used and is the most practical in 2D problems, and consists on integrating g along the crack, between a crack with cello length to a crack with the length that we want to have. For example, in this crack, we can calculate this problem, and we can calculate all the intermediate steps, and we will have a value of g, of the energy release rate for each one. And if we integrate this g, we will have the release energy between this state and this state. This is very practical because there are a lot of tools to obtain g due to the relevance of g in fracture mechanics. But in 3D problems, for example, it's very difficult to use because you're going to have a crack front, nor a crack tip. So you have to integrate, you have to solve a lot of problems because you have to solve all the intermediate steps. But in addition, you have to integrate over some type of steps and front line that is not so obvious. So for 3D problems, my recommendation is using one of the two next approaches. The first one is to use the external work increment. If you study this problem, you solve this problem, for example, with finite element, as we will see after, and you solve the state after the crack onset, you will have a change in the work of the external forces. So if you compare this work, you can obtain, it's not as easy, but you can find you have to take into account some boundary condition and all of that, but it can be done, and you are able to obtain the difference between the energy or the work between the two solids or between the two states, and with that you can obtain the release energy between the two states. The third form of doing that is the same idea behind the virtual crack closure technique, very used to predict to obtain g, but in this case we can use in an incremental form. That means that we are going to study the problem before the crack onset and after the crack onset, and with that we can obtain the release energy by multiplying the forces here in the state before the crack onset between the two phases versus the relative displacements at the state just after the crack onset. With that, we are able to obtain the release energy between the two. These two last methods to predict to obtain the release energy has the advantages that we don't need to integrate between intermediate steps, because if you have intermediate step, you have to solve more problems, you have to have more solutions of your problem with different crack geometries, and that is going to make more difficult or more heavy to solve your problem. So as for the dissipated energy, we can use the dissipated energy typically is approximated just using the fracture toughness times the area of the delta of the surface of the new crack surface. But well, if you have fracture modmicity, you have to use some approximation of the fracture toughness as a function of the modmicity, and you have to do some integration along the new crack surface. And if you use dimensionless, once you compare the delta pi with delta gamma, if you use dimensional analysis, you can find that delta pi, dimensionless delta pi, we can write like that, and delta gamma like that. And this is very advantageous because you can define an expression for sigma zero that is analogous to the expression of the stress criterion, but on the right hand side here, you're going to have a dimensionless brittle number gamma, a small gamma that you can see here. That is actually a function of material properties and a geometrical length parameter. And in addition, you are going to have a function g that is analogous to the s that you have in the stress criterion. That this is actually a function of delta sc. And this is very important because we are going to have the energy criterion and the stress criterion, both of them depending on the delta sc. So if they too depend on delta sc, to combine them, here we have a summary of the two expression. And if you have the two, we can express the general formulation of the couple criterion as you can see here. And this is very important because if you want to apply the problem, the couple criterion to a particular problem, you have just to focus on obtaining S. And how to obtain S? Well, solving the problem before the crack onset. How you obtain G here? You obtain G here, solving the problem after the crack onset and before the crack onset. So obtaining the release energy, basically, and the dissipated energy. And if you are able to do this, you have just to solve this optimization problem, because G and S are, this is what we have to find. Gamma is some number that depend on material properties, some problem properties that you have. And depending on gamma, we are going to have several scenarios that are very interesting, but we don't have time to explain here. So this is the general formulation. So in next examples, we are going to try to focus on obtaining S and G and apply this idea. Okay? So some examples. We have five examples. First of all, this is crack initiation at a weak surface in a V-notch. Why? I'm going to present that because this is an example of using an approximative analytic method to solve the problem. It means to obtain S and G, small g. And in addition, it's an example of relevant or shear stresses and the importance of fracture modmicity. The problem is what you can see on the left. We are going to have a small plate with a corner with a V notch here of an angle omega, and along this horizontal line we have a weak surface. That means that at this surface the material is going to be weaker in the sense of fracture toughness and in addition of material strength. And we are going to vary the mixity that we put in the corner by introducing an Arcan tool that you can see here, and applying the load at different points of this tool. For example, when we apply the, at this point, we are going to have mode one, pure mode one. And if we move this forward, we are going to introduce mixity in our corner. So this is a problem that has been very studied. It is a non-exhaustive list of reference. But the problem here is that you can see on the right is an opening angle. We are going to focus on the corner. And the interesting thing here is that the problem here is very complicated to solve, but we are going to focus on the situation around the corner. And around the corner, we have an asymptotic solution for stresses. And using match asymptotic, we can obtain this S and G that we saw before. And in addition, it's interesting because we have in relevance of shear stressing in the weak surface and stressmicity in the energy dissipation. The objective of this exercise was to evaluate if the crack is going to grow along the weak surface or along the bulk. Well, we know well that we have the Whelan expansion for the stresses around the corner that is given by this series of terms that there are infinite, as you know, where the important things are key one and key two, that are the generalized stress intensity factor. And very important that they are linear with external forces. We have also lambda one and lambda two that are the singularity exponent that control the harness of the singularity that we have in the corner. And we have some dimensionless angular function S1 and S2. With that, we can develop the value of sigma and tau. To take into account that the two first modes, we can define some equivalent key with some parameters controlling the mixity A and B. And with that, we can write again the expression before using this here. And from this sigma, we can obtain the normal stress and the shear stress with this expression here. Once we have sigma and tau, we can obtain the sigma equivalent that this is written here. And we can compare this with this sigma C, this is an errata. With that, this is actually already the stress criterion. Note that we don't have the analytic solution, but we have an approximative solution. And this is what we use here. In addition, in comparison, in contrast with the previous problem of open hole plate, here we have the presence of tau C that this can be very important in the weak surface. As for the release energy, we have using again match asymptotic, weak or asymptotic extension of here, we can obtain delta pi. That is going to depend on other coefficient as you saw before. And key equivalent here is again the same load parameter that you observed before. Delta gamma again is not GC times the crack length, but is GC times the some parameter that control the influence of the fracture modmicity in the opening crack. So delta gamma is calculated as you can see here. Here you can use, for example, so the Hutchinson and Su expression. Well, if you have the release energy and the dissipated energy, you can make this dimensionless, and we can obtain key equivalents as a function of this GC bar. That is this is the combination of the fracture toughness that we saw before. And with that expression, and the expression before for the stress criterion, we can obtain an equation as we obtained before for the open hell plate that solves LC. And in this case, we are able to isolate LC and to solve with, sorry, it's not isolated. We have the LC along these points. Well, so we have to solve this nonlinear equation to obtain LC. And once we have LC, we will able to obtain the key equivalent. And with the key equivalent, we obtain the force necessary to the crack onset, because remember that key equivalent and key one and key two are proportional. So what was the objective of this problem and what we obtain using this? We obtain, as you can see here, the we are able to predict if the crack is going to grow along the weak surface or along the bulk. And we obtain in this figure that depending on omega, that is the opening angle of the notch, and beta, that is the angle of the force, we obtain that this is a region, a combination of beta and omega, where the failure is in the bulk, and other region where the failure is at the weak surface. This is a very interesting result that can be obtained by the finite fracture mechanics, just introducing much asymptotic to the general formulation that we saw before. A second example is the failure initiation at spherical particle reinforced composites. This, the problem is what you can see here. If you have a composite here composed by spherical inclusions, for example, a steel spherical inclusion, we are going to typically have that the crack initiation occurs at some of the poles of the sphere. So to study this problem, we don't have analytic solution, especially for energy, and we need to extract the result from boundary elements or finite element. In this case, this is an example of using boundary elements. For the stress criterion definition, we are going to have, again, the relevance of shear stresses. And for the energy criterion, we are going to have fracture modmicity. Why? Because the crack is going to grow along the sphere and is going to entering into mode two. So this is the problem. We are not going to enter into detail, but the idea is to evaluate the crack onset between this state on the left to this state on the right, from any debond to a debond of some certain angle. So we, in this case, due to the relevance of shear stresses, we define the sigma equivalent that we saw in the general formulation, as you can see here. It's just a polynomial expression, where mu is the ratio of tau c versus sigma c, and using this boundary element model that you can observe on the right, where we put the inclusion very very small compared to the cell, and we use interface mechanics with contact and so on, we have the result for sigma tau and sigma equivalent before the crack onset. And this is what you can see in blue, red, and purple here. So with this sigma equivalent, this is the representation of the stresses, we have the S. Okay, if we moving on to the energy criterion, we need the release energy. How we are going to obtain the release energy here? This is a 2D problem, actually, because it is an asymmetric problem. So we are going to use the idea of integrating the value of G, of the energy release rate. To do that, we need to compute all the problems with all the cracks of the crack angles that we have between 0 and 90 degrees. So this is an example of Venn model where the crack tip is here, but we study all the crack tips. So this is the crack, for example, but we study other cracks larger and smaller. Actually, in each point of this plot on the right, you can see every point that you can see here of G versus the debound angle are a different model from boundary elements. So we use boundary elements, we use BCCT to extract the energy release rate, and we obtain G versus the theta D, the debound angle. And to predict, for example, the release energy of a crack of 40 degrees, we have to integrate this G between 0 and 40 degrees. As for the dissipated energy, it's approximated using the GC given by the Hutchinson-Isuo. So we need the stress mixity of the crack tip, and we integrate just GC using this phenomenological law. So here you have S and gamma and G, and you have the two expressions that we have in the general formulation, and you have the plot that you can observe here. You have sigma infinite versus delta theta. Delta theta is the length or the angle of the crack after the onset. In blue, you can observe the the curve for the curve for the stress criterion. Okay, this is actually S. And in red, you can observe the square root of G multiplied by gamma. So for different value of gamma, we are going to have different red curves. You have here two examples for gamma equals 0.5 and 1.5. And you can observe that the minimum load fulfilling the two criteria. What means fulfilling the two criteria? As you can see here, the stress criterion and the energy criterion is larger or equal in two cases. So it means to fulfill the two criteria means to have to be above the curves, the two curves. So for example, for gamma equals 0.5, that corresponds to this red curve, the minimum load fulfilling the two criteria is going to be this point. So the crack, the critical remote load is going to be that. But for a larger gamma, that is this point, the minimum load fulfilling the two criteria is going to be the minimum of the red curve. This is going to be this. Actually, as you can see, it is an optimization problem. But in this case, we can put this optimization problem in a in a very simple curve. So we did some experiments. I'm not going to enter into the detail of the experiments, but we did some experiment to evaluate the size effect that is predicted by the Kappler criterion, and we found this result. The red curves, as you can see, is the prediction of the Kappler criterion for the remote stress as a function of the inclusion radius. And the points are the experimental result. And as you can see, the agreement is very good. So another example that is very interesting because it's 3D and this is using the extraction from finite elements is the transverse cracking problem in cross-ply laminates. It's a very classical problem because from the 70s of the last century, we know that there are some type of size effects in transverse cross-ply laminates where if you go to a small or small thickness laminate, you are going to find that the apparent strength of the laminate is going to grow, basically. And this is very strange from the point of view of a stress criterion because that this is used typically in composite. Because the failure criteria of composite doesn't predict or don't predict this type of size effect. So we are going to study this from the point of view of the Kappler criterion using a 3D model. In particular, if you have here the cross ply, and you have here the plane where we are going to assume that the crack is going to grow, and we plot this plane here, we are going to try to open a crack that is with a geometry that is given by two parameters. One is the thickness of the crack, and other one is the depth. In addition, we are going to study if the crack is inside or outside, or of the, not outside, sorry, it's inside or it's in the free edge of the layer. So for that, we use ArcGIS, and first of all, we generate an uncrack ArcGIS model. From this ArcGIS uncrack model, we obtain the stresses, and with the stresses, we obtain the function S that we saw in the general formulation. And this is the stresses. And for the energy, the released energy is a little bit more complicated. We need to introduce every crack that we want to study. And we have a lot of crack to study. So we isolate some region of our problem, we use FRAM3D, and we generate some models, some models with cracks over here. Using symmetry and so on, we can obtain different crack inside the laminate, outside at the free edge, etc. And we use 540 models to solve this, that ranging from some millions of degree of freedom, that is more or less complicated, and we obtain the release energy using the clack closure technique, the incremental clack closure technique that we saw before. And using Abacus scripting, we can do that in an automatic way, and we obtain the result for the energy criterion. That is the same curve that we saw before, but now for a 3D problem, that you can see here that delta A and delta B are the two geometrical parameters governing the crack geometry after the onset. Before, we have only one, for example, delta theta or delta L. Here we have two, and you have the these surfaces correspond to the critical onset, the critical remote stress for the crack inside the laminate and crack at the free edge. And we can compare this with 2D analysis that we did before, and we find a very good agreement, and that is with experiment. But the idea, the important point here is that we can obtain, using ArcGIS, we can obtain the crack, the released energy using the incremental crack closure technique here. If once we have the released energy for each crack, we just have a G, and with G, we can apply the energy criterion. So the last example is the automatic implementation. There are two examples. So one is using Abacus scripting. Again, we can define the problem with an optimization problem that you can see here. The idea of this if-M code is that you have for an user that doesn't know almost anything about finite fracture mechanics, but she is able to introduce an input file in ArcGIS with the geometry, the material properties, the boundary condition, the loads, and the mesh, and the fracture properties, the strength, and the fracture toughness, and also some settings, for example, what finite fracture mechanics criterion, what particular setting for the finite fracture mechanics criterion, for example, if we are, going to use pointwise or average, etc. And introducing that in the FF code, the objective is to obtain the factor key C multiplying the load at crack onset. That means for which factor we are going, we have to multiply our loads in the linear elastic model to have the crack initiation. Is this, this is the same idea used to predict, for example, buckling in using an eject value problem. So the output of this code is the factor and also the location and geometry of the crack after the onset in order to go on with this problem using for example, BCCT or other approaches. What is insight? FF encode. The insight is just the optimization problem that we saw in the general formulation. We have an objective function and an optimization algorithm as typically to optimization problems. And inside the objective function, that is the interesting thing here, we are going to have, inside the stress criterion, we are going to have the result before, where a key SC is going to be sigma C over the functional F that we defined before. Note that this functional F depends on delta S. And for the energy criterion, we are going to have a similar expression. Okay, that is delta gamma over delta pi. But the important thing here is that this objective function defined as that is going to take the crack geometry as an input. It's going to take the as an output, it's going to take key CC. That is the maximum of the two obtained before for key SC and key EC. But this is very important because our objective function is going to give this factor and the arguments, the variable to be varied to optimize this objective function is going to be the this delta SC. So we obtain a key CC, we evaluate this is the minimum that we want to obtain. If not, we try with other new crack geometry, and this crack geometry we introduce in the objective function and apply the stress and energy criterion. We obtain key SC, key EC, maximize, we take the maximum of the two, and we obtain key CC. And again, we evaluate this is if this is the minimum, and again we take this loop as how many times as is necessary. And after that, once the optimization algorithm has been evaluated, we take the output for critical factor and the crack geometry. This is the idea, and this is can be this is was implemented using XFEM, but it can be implemented using other type of tools to predict the release energy. The last there's an example there, but the last I want to talk about some other finite element implementation, very promising and very robust and very suitable for many applications. That this is using directly finite elements and to look for the elements where the stress criterion is fulfilled. Once we have the elements where the stress criterion or the Gauss integration point where the stress criterion is fulfilled, we are going to look for cracks growing at these regions. And if we find a crack that is growing at this region, we allow this crack concept and we will have the crack initiation. This is, we have 1 minute left, so we are going to explain this over these figures, and I think it's going to be easier. We have here an open hole plate, a corner actually, a soft stress concentration, and we have plotted in green all the elements where the stress criterion is fulfilled, and this region is growing, as you can imagine, when I increase the load. And at some point, at some time, we will have that one crack inside this green region is going to fulfill the energy criterion. And actually, we can look for the best crack fulfilling this energy criterion. And at this point was that. So in red, you can see the elements that are cutted by the new crack. So we remove all these elements and we can go on growing the crack, as you can see here. This is the initial crack, and if you evaluate again the region where the crack can grow, this is the green the, where the stress criterion is fulfilled, and we obtain this other crack growth. And with that, we you can see here the nice publication, and they can solve very difficult problem, as you can see here, where we have two initial cracks, and the crack growth of this initial crack that is not so obvious can be predicted in an automatic way using this idea. So this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attendance.